that's found in the Bible. And my pet story from last week is pretty good, but it's not as good as, not nearly as good as the actual Christmas story. So what we're doing over the next few weeks is we are diving into different characters of the Christmas story, and we're extracting, taking out of those stories some practical life application that we can apply to our lives. It's important for you to know this, that the Bible, even though it is an old text, it's not an out-of-date text. Just because it's old doesn't make it out of date. In fact, I will challenge you, read it, and you'll find out how relevant it is to your day and to our day and age right now. It's relevant. The Word of God is alive. It speaks to us. And there's revelation. There's this thing, illumination that God can bring to us to apply to our lives. And ultimately, that is done. God has it that way so that we can live for Him. Amen? And so everything we need to know about life and how to traverse this earth is found in the Word of God. Today, we're going to focus in on one character. His name is Joseph. Not Joseph with the coat of many colors, but Joseph, Jesus' stepdad. Earthly father. See, I didn't think you were right. I thought somebody would go, oh, that's funny. Yeah, I see what you did there. All right. I won't share with you what Molly Hoyle wanted me to share. I'll share that at another point. But Jesus has his heavenly father is God the Father. Well, his earthly father is Joseph. And there's not a lot in the Bible about Joseph, but there's enough that's very important and teaches us a lot about how to things that we can apply to our lives today. The story of Joseph, there's a part of the story in Matthew chapter 1, verses 18 through 21. Matthew chapter 1, verses 18 through 21. The Bible says this. This is how Jesus, the Messiah, was born. His mother, Mary, was engaged to be married to Joseph. But, somebody say but. But before the marriage took place, while she was still a virgin, she became pregnant through the power of the Holy Spirit. Someone say scandalous. Now, it wasn't scandalous because we know what happened, but at that moment when Joseph finds out that she's pregnant, I mean, what would you be thinking? Verse 19, Joseph, to whom she was engaged, was a righteous man. Some say righteous man. And did not want to disgrace her publicly, so he decided to break the engagement quietly. Now, you need to understand, there's a lot of things Joseph could have done at that moment. Honestly, he could have had her stoned. He could have had her disbanded. He could have embarrassed her. Yet, I believe he takes on the characteristic of God in this. He decides to walk in justice, break it off, but at the same time, give mercy. That is God's nature. God is a just God. He's a God of justice. In fact, it's important for us to know this today. We do not serve a fair God. God never promised in His Word that He's fair. But He is always just. And that's extremely important, and it's good. So He's just, but He's also super merciful. I don't know about you today, but I'm thankful that we serve a merciful, wonderfully merciful God. Amen? Verse 20. As he considered this, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream. Joseph, son of, actually, it's an angel, so it'd be more like this. Joseph, son of David, the angel said, do not be afraid to take Mary as your wife, for the child within her is conceived by the Holy Spirit. And she will have a son, and you shall call him Jesus. I don't know where my accent's going right there, but it's getting kind of cool, I might say. For he will save the people from their sins. That's literally how it happened, if you were wondering. It was an awesome moment. And Joseph really plays a pivotal part in the Christmas story. Sometimes he's considered like a bystander in the background. But I believe that Joseph was a pivotal character within not only the Christmas story, but the upbringing of Jesus. In fact, I would say this. There's certain things about Joseph that I believe that God, that yes, Mary was chosen, but I also think Joseph was chosen as well. And I want you to picture with me, kind of go with me in a little journey here, a little reality of this was. Imagine a woodworking shop. Imagine you just opened a walk into a woodworking shop. It's filled with the scent of sawdust and the smell of freshly cut wood. You hear the sound of tools like Husqvarna chainsaws and they didn't have those back then. But you hear the sound of the clinging and the clanging of those types of woodworking tools from that time. Now imagine you see a man, a humble man in the corner, shaping and molding and meticulously building something beautiful out of that wood. The man is Joseph. He's a humble carpenter, but he's also well respected in the community. Back then, if you had the title carpenter, you had that meant you were a hard worker. That meant you had respect. And honestly, I respect every carpenter in the building today, because guess what? Without you, we'd be in trouble. If you left it up to me to build things, we'd end up with three-legged tables. Now, they may stand, I might figure it out, but it wouldn't go very well. But you know what? As I think about Joseph and how much he might be known as a carpenter, I think he had a bigger reputation for being a loving, good father. I believe that if you take a look at Jesus' life, you need to understand this about Joseph. Joseph had a huge impact in the upbringing of Jesus. I want you to take a look at like the meticulousness of it. Has anybody ever done any woodworking before? Maybe made a piece of furniture? Or in school, we did I tried to make a couch in school one time. And it ended up being a plate. Because, you know, you try to mold and shape the arms, and then it just whittles down. Okay, fine. It's a flat surface. But I put a few grooves in it to make it look like it was ornamental. If you've ever done detailed work like that, you'll know that it takes a lot of detail. It's meticulous work. And I just want to kind of correlate that to parenting today, or correlate that to your place of work, or if you're a leader here today, that a lot of the time, the work that God gives us to do takes some effort and energy. It can be meticulous. And I want you to know this today, that God is doing a meticulous work on you, and he's doing a meticulous work on me. Can I get an amen? So as we raise the next generation, as we lead those around us, as we help disciple people and help people come to the saving knowledge of Jesus Christ, we need to understand that the same type of energy and effort that a carpenter would take to a piece of wood is kind of what God does in each and one of our, every one of our hearts. Amen? Joseph, I want to just leave this with you. There are times when God will entrust us. This is something that Joseph brings to us. There are times when God will entrust us with stewarding something beyond our natural abilities. Certainly, Joseph experienced that. I mean, imagine you in Joseph's shoes. Like, here you are. You're the earthly father of the Savior. I was at the first service, as I was worshiping, I got thinking about how, ever since the moment I became a born-again Christian until now, that song, you know, Another in the Fire, I felt like, you know what, I've been in the fire since I became a Christian. I felt like I'm in over my head, like I'm in too deep, that I'm beyond what my capabilities, my talents, everything could take me. And you know what I've grown to do is I've grown to be accustomed to that and enjoy that, because here's what I've noticed: when you're in the fire, there's another one in there with you. And that when you, that there's another one that you can lean on, that you can glean from, that it's not all about your talents and your abilities and what you can do. It's all about what he can do. Can I get an amen from somebody today? And so I feel like that was Joseph's life, just trying to raise Jesus. And it's also important for us to recognize that at some point in our lives, God is going to give you the opportunity, responsibilities to be in over your head. And we shouldn't shun from it. We shouldn't be shy of it. We should embrace it. Can I get an amen? We should embrace the opportunity to get in over our heads sometimes. But I also think that Joseph was a normal guy in a lot of ways. I think he was a normal father. In fact, I think that there were times when Joseph probably went to Jesus. I can picture Joseph when Jesus was a teenager, going into Jesus' room while Jesus was hanging out with his friends, and said, "Hey, Joseph, I got to tell you," or "Hey, Jesus, I got to tell you something." "What's that, Dad?" "Why don't eggs tell jokes?" "Because they might crack up." And I can picture Jesus saying, "Come on, Dad, no time for those kind of jokes." "No, no, 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 one more. How does a penguin build its house?" "It glues it together." I can picture Jesus getting red in the face. If you don't get igloos it together. I want you to picture Jesus like you're embarrassing me in front of my friends. I just want one more Jesus, just one more. We did fine. I told my wife, your mother, she could embrace her mistake. So she turned around and gave me a hug. But a hump. I began, Joseph stopped telling those Abba jokes. Come on now. Anybody get that? A couple of you getting it a little bit. Yeah. Dad jokes are from the Bible. You may not have known that. But I do think that a lot of the ways that we struggle today are the ways that Joseph would have struggled. I think there were, I mean, literally, think about it. Joseph is a father who left his son and left the city with his mom behind. Like, they forgot their kid. It's like if you're at Walmart. You know, you're going through your Christmas shopping, and you're doing your thing, and then all of a sudden you get to the car and you realize, oh, no, I left little Johnny at the checkout aisle. It's like, that's pretty bad, isn't it? Well, guess what? Jesus' parents did the same thing to him. So I say Jesus gets us in that way. So we know that Joseph was a carpenter. We know that he was a carpenter. But what else we know about him is that God was able to trust Joseph. So my thing today that I want to drive out and pull out of Joseph's life is how to be trusted by God. Can you be trusted by God? I believe that God wants us to be someone who he can trust. And I think Joseph shows us that by two specific things that we know. I'm not making anything up about Joseph. I'm not taking my poetic license. I'm going to go specifically from what the Word of God shows us. There's two things that show us that God could trust Joseph. And the first thing was this, was that Joseph was a righteous man. Joseph was a righteous man, and a righteous man was he. I say it that way just so you can remember. Now, righteousness, when you use the word righteousness, people sometimes have a lot of different definitions. And I'm not, there's a bigger definition to righteousness than what I'm going to share with you right now. But I want to give you something practical for you to be able to go home with. And we'll define righteousness this way. Living a life in alignment with God's character. Righteousness is living a life in alignment with God's character. And listen, if you've got a bulletin today, hey, if you have a bulletin, lift it up. If you got a bulletin today, all right. Good. Awesome. Everyone that's holding it up, take it with you today. Don't leave it inside. But there's also notes on the back of that. You can write this stuff down. Living a life that's in alignment with God's character. Here's what I think about righteousness. Righteousness leads to further blessing from the Lord. Why? Because when we walk in righteousness, God can trust that when he blesses us, that we're going to steward the blessing properly. And so God will give us opportunities, God will bless us, and then what we do with the blessing makes a big difference on whether or not we experience further blessing. And so I think if we want to walk in blessing, if we want to experience that, we want to walk in righteousness, there's five areas of our life that I'm going to throw at you really quickly, because we have communion real soon, that I want to throw at you, because I want you to get these five things. The first thing is this, how do we handle our time? The second one is this, how do we handle our relationships? The third is this, how do we handle our money? The fourth, and I don't have these on the screen for you, how do we handle our faith? And the fifth is, how do we handle our sin? See, if the answer to any one of those or all of those is, well, selfishly, I handle this thing selfishly, then that means there's room for improvement. That means that we're not living the righteous life that God wants us to live. That means, see, but living a life in alignment with God's character. God is not selfish. I hope you're getting this today. Get this in your spirit today, because it will make a difference. The first one, how do we handle our time? Listen, are we living according to God's time or our own time? In other words, is our time all about ourselves and we're selfish with our time, or are we selfless and we're giving of our time? How do we handle our relationships? Are our relationships God-honoring? This isn't a part of the message where it's like the in-crowd and the out-crowd. And the question is, are you the same person regardless of who you're around? Is your relationship God-honoring? Are your relationships bringing you up or are they pulling you down? Are they bringing you closer to God or are they pulling you further from God? Are you a mechanism for God? In fact, are you a good person to be in relationship with? That's a really great question to ask from time to time. Am I somebody that other people that can lean on and grow closer to God in? How we handle our relationships is key. How we handle our money. Do we work for our money, or do we make our money work for us? Is money our God? If money is your God, then God wants to bring you freedom today from that. How we handle our faith. I know I'm hitting these pretty fast. I could probably do a whole message on each and every one of these, but I'm going in the direction the Lord wanted me to go today. Just kind of hit you with it. How we handle our faith. Are we faithful only when we're in trouble? When we pray, do we only pray like when we're in a oh-shoot kind of moment? Or is there some faithfulness to our lives and consistently going? And then my favorite is this. How do we handle our sin? A righteous, the Bible says this in the book of Proverbs. A righteous man falls 7 times and gets back up again. See, if we have a tendency to isolate and hide and disconnect, then we're not living the righteous life that God wants us to live. But if we fall short, we run to the cross and say, hey, God, guess what? It's me again. I messed up again. What can you do to help me? That is how we live a righteous life. Now, it's not about how many times. It's what, I said this in the first service. It's righteousness is what you do with what you do. It's what you do with what you do. If you do, you mess up, you fall short, if you're a Yankees fan or a Jets fan or any other, a 49ers fan, you can still be righteous. I mean, you've got a lot of work to go. I mean, there's a little hope for you. It's a little. But what you do with what you do, oh my goodness, people are like Superman right now, pulling down their overshirt and like Superman, but it's the 49ers. I'm really not a 49ers fan. But I am a little salty because the Patriots are not very good this year. It's what you do with what you do. If you fall short, if you mess up, if you come up short from God's glory, what do you do? Do you run to the foot of the cross? Do you run to Jesus? Do you run to a place of refuge? Or do you isolate and turn and run the opposite direction? Listen, the righteousness isn't the decision. Righteousness is whether what do you do with what you do. Somebody needs to know this today. And that Christianity is not about a list of do's and don'ts. It's about a Savior, Jesus. That's why I want to emphasize today, what does Christmas mean to me? It means Jesus. It's all about Jesus. If it was not for Jesus, there'd be no Christmas. Come on now. And so today, if you're here today and you've heard all kinds of things about Jesus, here's what you need to know about Jesus today, that he's a good, good God. That there's no better friend that you'll ever have than Jesus. But the people are going to let you down. It's just life. It's just going to happen. But listen, if we have Jesus in the right place in our life, it doesn't really matter when people let us down. It doesn't affect us as bad. Why? Because we just assume people can be jerks. And here's the good news. You have the liberty to be a jerk yourself. Welcome to the Christmas service. Come to the Christmas service where you're going to learn how much of a jerk you are this year. Listen, if we're honest, we all deserve coal in our stocking. But the reality is that we serve a good, good God. Jesus, I love this, and somebody has to hear this today, that as much as God knows everything about you and me, absolutely everything, there's not one thing that God does not know about us. Like, people know the things we do. Jesus, God knows the things we think. And yet, you've heard me say this before, if you've been coming for any amount of time, despite the knowledge that God has about us, he still loves us. Isn't that amazing? Come on now, like if your friends, if your friends knew half the things you did, I'll just leave that there. Now, if everybody knew the things you think, you'd have no friends. Like, they'd be like, whoa, that's a psycho. Well, the problem, imagine this, a room this full. We're surrounded by a bunch of psychos. But thankfully, God puts a barrier where we do not have to listen. We cannot read each other's thoughts. We just don't. for that. But he knows our every thought. Think of how mighty and powerful that is. He knows our every thought, yet he sent Jesus Christ to die for us because he loves us that much. Isn't that awesome? See, Joseph was a righteous man, and a righteous man was he. See, if for us to walk in righteousness, we have to have right relationship with Jesus. Because we cannot do it on our own. Listen, the way we handle our time, our relationships, our money, our faith, and our sin, we're incapable of handling it the right way without the great grace of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And so if you come in today to church and you're like, oh man, I feel like a crud, and yeah, he's right, I'm horrible. Like, well, pause. Pause there for a second. Because we are made righteous through Christ Jesus. The Bible says this, that we are the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. So I want to read it this way. We are living a life in alignment with God's character as long as we're in Christ Jesus. You get it? Are you getting that? So as long as if we're in Christ Jesus, he empowers us to live a life in alignment with God's character. We're capable of doing that. Now, it's up to you and me to decide to actually do that and not let our flesh take over. Because why I say that is just because you're a born-again Christian, just because you have Jesus, doesn't mean you're going to make the right decisions. The good news is you have the power to make the right decisions. So, you got to get this. If you want to be a righteous man, if you want to be part of the righteous brothers and sisters and experience the benefits of that lifestyle, here's what you got to do. You have to watch how you live. Pay attention to it. Allow God to work on you and in you. All right. First thing is that God trusted Joseph because he was a righteous man. God trusted Joseph because Joseph was a godly man. And I'm going to run through this very fast, okay? You ready for it? Joseph was a godly man. What is a godly man? So this is going to really appeal for the men of the church, but it doesn't mean that it doesn't apply to the women of the church. There's aspects of this that every person, whether you're male or female, you can apply this to your life. But I don't think we speak to the men enough. And I want to speak directly to all the men that are in the church, that are here in live or online today. I want to speak to some men. Because there's a thing that God gives us. Can I? I got to do it. God gives us authority. And the problem today for a lot of men is that we don't walk in the authority that God called us to walk in. And so there's one specific, there's authority to be godly. And godly, I can break down into three areas. There may be more, but for today, just three. And it's priest, provider, and protector. These are three areas of authority that God wants every man to walk in. Priest, provider, and protector. Now, when I use the word priest, automatically, if you're like unchurched or you haven't been in church all your life, like, wait a minute, am I supposed to get like a collar or something? Like, am I supposed to go, oh? Because that's what we think when we hear priest. We think like some weird looking guy in a weird brown robe walking around going, I bless you, Lord, yes I do. See, I don't need you to laugh at myself. I laugh at myself. I don't need you to laugh at me. Oh, holy water, sword on your face. See, there's been a disservice to the body of Christ, making people think that there's only a select group of Jesus, the priests. No, the Bible says that we are a royal priesthood, we're a chosen generation. So for even the ladies in the room today, you need to know this, that we are a royal priesthood. And so we really make it like super religious when we hear priest, but I want to make it super practical because there's multiple facets to a priesthood, but one specific facet is this, and I want to camp out here for just 2 minutes, and it's this, that a priest, one of the main roles of a priest is preparation. Our role and our responsibility in this place is to prepare each other for the coming of the Lord. We're to prepare the next generation for what they're going to face on this earth. It's maybe a better term for it to help you. It means training. It means as the men of this church, we need to get on board with, number one, training ourselves in godliness. About to train yourself up in godliness for physical fitness profits a little, but training in godliness is profitable for all things. And so there's a training aspect to this priestly authority that God wants us to do, to walk in. And so we're to train up the next generation in how to live a godly life. See, sometimes, you heard me say protector is a part of it, but here's the problem. Sometimes we overprotect and underprepare. I'm preaching now. This is vital for the life of the church that God wants for this church in the future here, is that we need to... Too many Christians overprotect and underprepare. Get obsessed with protection, protect, protect, protect. You know, before I became a full-time pastor, I was working pretty much in ministry full-time, but I also was working at a counseling agency, and I dealt with really troubled families. And a lot of those troubled families in Maine actually come from a very religious background. And probably, I would say approximately 100 or so different families that I worked with directly that had this religious experience, this is what their problem was every time. They were overly protective and underprepared. In other words, they didn't set the next generation up for success. They guarded the next generation from everything that could harm them, and what ended up happening was the next generation never built up an immunity to successfully take on the world that they were about to be thrust into. And so I could tell just by the sound in the place. And so here's two things I feel like the Lord gave me. And you just let the Lord minister to you whether that is true or not for you. But here, the number one thing is this, that if we don't train the next generation, raise up the next generation properly, the first thing is, if we overprotect and underprepare, what we're going to create is a fearful and weak person, or a fearful and weak generation. Isolationist. Ooh, watch out for that, watch out for that. In other words, like very legalistic, but super fearful. The other type of person we end up raising up is a person who is enthralled by the world and is dragged into it. So, just to get real practical with you, the world's awful, the world's evil, those people are terrible, and no interaction at all. And then the first time you run into somebody in the world, you realize, wow, they actually tell the truth more than my Christian friends. Oh, wow, wait a minute. My Christian, these people gossip all the time, and they're always backbiting, talking about how they're terrible and they're terrible. I've never heard this person say one bad thing about anybody ever. See, what happens if we overprotect and underprepare, we end up messing up the next generation. But if we prepare them, overprotection comes from a place of fear and anxiety within the believer. And what I want to empower you today to do is understand, fathers especially, but mothers as well, it's time to put on the hat of a coach. It's time to train up the next generation in the way that they should go, so that when they're older, they will not depart from it. Can I get an amen from somebody? What we need to do is we need to lead with vision for the next generation, not lead with fear. We need to lead with inspiration of the Holy Spirit, not with fear. We need to trust that the days ahead of us are better than the days behind us because of the work that the Holy Spirit can do in our household. Can I get an amen from somebody today? One of the ways to prepare the next generation is this, is that help them understand that Christianity isn't about what God can do for you. See, what happened, the millennial generation is really struggling right now because there's so few millennials serving God. And I think it's because they've come up under a gospel where it's like the gospel is all about what Christianity can do for you. And so what we need to get people to understand is not about what Christianity can do for you, it's what we can do for God. It's not about this, because what happens is as soon as we start to feel that Christianity isn't serving us any longer, come on now, all of a sudden now we ditch it like we do every other product we use. Oh, the acne cream's not working anymore. Throw that out. Oh, that's not working anymore. Throw that out. See, Christianity isn't about how it's working or not working. Christianity is based on the truth of Jesus Christ and the fact that He rose from the dead and He's coming back someday for His church. Can I get an amen from someone? See, that's the life-giving message. And here's the beauty of it. I believe that God's people should flourish. The problem is we just shouldn't live for the flourishing. We should live for the flourisher. We should live for the one that will make us flourish. I believe that God will make his people prosper. I believe that Christians shouldn't be the brokest people in a community. I believe that, Christians shouldn't be the sickest people in a community. I believe that the prosperity of God can come in and make his people flourish. That's just not the focus. We need to be focused on the provider. Can I get an amen? So, all right. So, as godly men and godly women, we can walk in the authority of a priest. We can also walk in the authority. We need to walk in the authority of a provider. Listen, Joseph was a carpenter. Back in that day with that title, he was a hard-working man. Listen, we are called to be hard workers. I know this blasphemy. I probably just got taken off Facebook for that statement. But, listen, godly people do not walk around with an entitlement mentality. Salvation is free, nothing else is. We need to be examples in our community of what hard work can do. And finally, protecting. I had a few illustrations I wanted to use with this one, but then the Holy Spirit helped me not be dumb on this point. But God has called us to be protectors. That means we're not called to be weak. That means that we're not called to be, Lord Jesus, help me like systemize this and make it. Okay. Whipped is another one. All right. Wimp. That's right. Wimp. Like, we're not called to be wimps. Listen, we're called to have a backbone. There we go. Instead of looking at the negative, I'm going to look at the positive. You know what we are? We're called to have backbones. We're called to stand firm in Christian values and biblical principles. Come on now. We're called to know who we are and to know who we're not. We're called to be one of the ways we can protect is by interceding for the next generation and be prayer warriors. See, I love King David. I think David is a perfect example for us and the good things he did. See, David was a manly man. I mean, he killed bears and giants and all kinds of stuff. He was a warrior. Can I get an amen? I mean, he was a concealed carrier with his slingshot and a stone. Come on. That's for real. Yet at the same time, the dude wrote poetry. Now, I'm not quite that way yet on that side. I'm working on the sensitive side. But my wife's working on me. For us, you know what that means as protectors? That we can show the next generation how it is to be tough. I remember growing up, my dad cut his pinky half off with a saw. And he comes inside, he's like, I might have did something. He doesn't talk like that accent. For some reason, that accent's just coming out today. But I remember, you know what he did? He duct taped it back together. He duct taped it. His arm fell off 3 weeks later. Listen, this is not, I'm not giving any medical advice today. But he duct-taped his finger back together. I had the privilege of seeing my dad be a tough protector. I remember one time I got knocked out playing football. I was a freshman. Like, two of the players before me got injured because the team we were playing against was the University of Maine or something. It's huge. They were all, like, huge. I was a freshman. And I got knocked out. And the coach, had to pick me up and he's going to put me back in. And I was like, I don't think I can go in, coach. Like, why? I'm like, I can't see. Not good. And I remember, the coach was like, just get in there. And I remember hearing this voice from the stadium, from the bleachers. I can't exactly tell you what he said. Because I'm a pastor. But it essentially was, get your hands off my kid, let him sit on the sideline, or I'm going to come down and show you something. I'm not saying we do that kind of stuff, but what I'm saying is, let men be men again. Children need to know that their dad has their back. Come on. There has to be that sense of, the warrior mindset that believe that men in church need to start carrying and going forward. You know what that also means? It means that we... Thank you, Holy Spirit. I'm going to pause. If you're wondering, what just happened? What just happened was I was about to say something. That was my opinion. And I'm just going to stop there. Worship team, come on up. That'd be great. We need to walk in the authority that God's given us as priest, provider, protector. I want the Holy Spirit to empower some men here today to be able to put your foot down when you need to put it down and have grace when you need to have grace. Come on now. You may feel, man, the whole weight of the world is on me. You want to know something? I'm not here to say the weight of the world is going to come off you. What I'm going to say is God has uniquely designed you as a man to be able to handle the weight of the world being on your shoulders for a little bit. And then what we need to do as men is learn to cast our cares upon the Lord, for He cares for us. Come on. God wants to raise up some strong, godly men.